Okay. I'm Cédric Krier. I work at UCK and occasionally I'm also the creator or the co-creator with of Tryton. And so this talk will be a kind of we will look at the past, the history of Tryton to refresh the memory of everybody. We will look at what we have now and what we could have in the future. So, first, what's Tryton? Tryton is... it's a platform for writing business software. It's written in GPL, so it means it's free software. You can use it freely, you can modify, you can distribute your modification, and so on. So you have all the freedom that the GPL gives you. We have more than 100 modules in Tryton, in base, in the core. And those modules cover a lot of topics. It's written in Python, so it's a very dynamic language, so that allows us to write, develop modules very fast and quickly. And we use mainly PostgreSQL as a database. We have support for other databases, but the main target is PostgreSQL, because it's a very nice database that works very well. And architecture is, of course, a three-tier architecture. So we have clients, server, and a database. To store the data. So, the history now. It all begins 10 years ago by forking what was named at this time Team ERP, which was another free software, written in Python and using PostgreSQL database. And now it's changed many times of names. So it was one time called OpenERP, and now it's Hadoop. So, as I said, Bertrand and me created Tryton, and indeed we were former employees of the company behind this ERP, and we were not happy with how things was working. And so we started Tryton by thinking that we could make it better. In a better way. So, few days. The first commit, it occurs 10 years ago. It was the starting point. And almost 1 year after that, we got the first release, the release 1.0. That's was a long time ago now, and four years after that, we created a foundation to support Tryton. The foundation was indeed created, I think, on the first conference we made, or the second conference we made, Liège. The foundation allows us to secure the project and prevent any derivation to closed source for Tryton or whatever, or the takeover of one company over the project or things like that. The foundation has a board of 7 members, I think. It was renewed this year. I guess it will be presented later today. the new board, and he's in charge of managing the website, the creating such event as the current conference. I think that's many other stuff, I guess, including the marketing as well. And then in 2015, we released the first web client. Before that, we have only a desktop client. And it was part of a crowdfunding project and that we succeeded to achieve. And now we have both two clients that works almost the same, a web client and a desktop client. And this year we got also for the new achievement, which is we provide the Docker image for the two last release, and we will continue for later. So it will ease the installation and the testing of Tryton. And by the way, I think it's better if you want to make it interactive and ask questions, I guess you can stop and raise your hand to if you have a question at any time. About the code. As you can see, since the beginning, the number of lines in Tryton has grown, but it's not out of control, I think. It grows quite slowly, but every year it's a little bit more and more and so on. We have just a small exception here. It's the Spanish chart of accounts that was added, and they have a lot of accounts. Indeed, there is two charts, so that makes a lot of code, but it's only data, so that doesn't make the maintenance of the software harder. What can we say more about it? Maybe we could add more comments in the code, because it's a little bit low, but or maybe the code is enough well-written and easy to read, but we don't have comments. The features. Tryton has accounting, so this means that we manage general accounting in Tryton. So we have a chart of account with manage taxes. We have reports, standard reports, like general ledger and so on. And we have also some features like assets depreciation or many small features that actually can like to have. We have templates on the moves and so on. We have also invoicing, so we can generate invoice. Customer and supplier invoice, they are also managed by other modules that create them. And we have restore for the exact layout of the reports for each invoices. So you can get back the former invoice 4 years or 10 years ago. It's stored in the database, and you will not lose it, even if you change the template. We have sales and leads and opportunity management. We have many small features on the sales, so we can do dropshipping with them. You can convert, of course, the leads and the opportunity into sales. The sales manage to make the shipments, to generate the invoice. We have many different methods for invoicing. We can invoice based on the shipments, or based on the order, or ship when the invoice is paid, and so on. We have also, we support prepayment, so you can request a payment from your customer to start the workflow of the sale and start shipping or you start shipping once the pre payment is done, for example. We manage also purchase with many features. We can purchase based on the request from the stock. We will have a presentation later today about new feature that we will get in purchase, the purchase requisition, purchase quotation. So on this side, tries to be well. Set up, yeah. We have also stock and inventory. The stock is based on double entry, so you never lose a product because when to move something, you have to put it somewhere else. So everything is always balanced. It allows you to be sure that we never forget a product somewhere. And the stock comes with customer shipments, supplier shipments, and internal shipments. We support many warehouses and any kind of structure for your location, like your warehouse. We can now support flat location and compute the stock quantity very fast. That's allowed to do chaos strategy for warehouse, for example. And of course we support also cost computation on average and on FIFO. We have also MRP, so the productions. We can produce in different warehouse. We support the work center and bombs, routing and so on. We can track time for each production and each work center you use for your production, and we compute the cost of your production at the end. So it's pretty a complete MRP one. We don't support yet MRP 2, where we have to include the capacity of work centers. That's a big stuff, and we're not yet ready for that. And we have also project data sheets. So it's more small modules, but very useful when you manage project and you want to invoice based on your time and so on. The project, you can have some reporting on it about the performance of the project, the revenue and the cost and so on. So instead of talking, I think it's easier to make a small demo of Tryton. So first, we have the desktop client. I will connect with the password. And we start with just the menu here, where you find all the main topics I told you. So you have the menu here, and when you open, you click on the menu, it opens a tab here with the content. And you can have multiple tabs, like that you can switch easily from one tab to another, and without having to close and move what you were doing. So here we have the parties, so it's a list of all the parties in your company. And when you click on the records, you get here the form of the party, and you see that you have names and so on. The screen is a little bit strange because the combination is my laptop and the projector. The size and the resolution doesn't separate. So normally it's a little bit smaller, all the widgets, and the font is a little bit bigger. So that's, you see how it looks. I don't know what can be shown. I propose to make just of the usual workflow in the company. We are going to sell something, see the shipments, purchase what we need to, what we have sold, and go to the until the generate the invoice. So first, we need to sell something. I can create a new product. I don't know what we can say.
T-shirts.
Ah, we sell t-shirts. It's a good. You can say if it's a good or a service. Goods are stuff that you manage in your warehouse. Services are stuff that you don't manage in your warehouse. assets, it's a kind of goods, but it's managed as an asset for the company. So we manage it in the stock like a good, but of course, on the accounting part, it's behaved differently and you can depreciate the asset and so on. Here you can define how it behaves. If it's a consumable, this means that we don't care about the quantity in the stock, something that we have always, and it's always there. It could be stuff like water that comes from the tap. You don't have to purchase. There is always water. You can define if it's producible. That means that you have to produce it with a production order and the bomb and so on. But here, to be quick, we will not make it producible. If you can purchase, it's something that we purchase to a supplier or not. I will say we will purchase it. And if it's sellable, so I can sell it to the customer. I have to choose the unit of measure. So this is it's a unit, because I will use one t-shirt at a time. Here you can see it's what we call a many-to-one. So the widget that allows you to select from another record from another table, and you can search on it quickly, and you have also a compression. If I type unit, find it, and I can open the definition once I select it, and if I want, I can define something on it. I have to define a list price for this. Let's say 50. The cost price, I can use fixed or average. Let's say average. And now here I can have multiple variants of the product for different size. I could make it one a medium, let's say. Like that, I have two sizes for the product. On the customer tab, I have the unit for sale. So I will sell also per unit, but I could decide to sell by package of 10 or whatever. I have a lead time here. It's the time I need to ship to prepare the shipment to the customer. For example, if the warehouse is big, or I have to first pick it from some place, or make some tests on it before making the shipment, I could put a little time. This means that when I will sell the product, it will compute automatically the date of the delivery, when we can deliver it. But here for t-shirts, I think there is no lead time, because you just take it from the location of the warehouse. As I said, we can purchase, I have also a supplier tab, where I can also define the units I purchase. And here, if, for example, I could say that I always purchase by boxes of 10, and so I have to here put that it's 10, and the precision is 1, and 0 digits. So I define all the, what are the kind of units or float number I can use with this unit. So it's only a factor of 10, and with surrounding position of 1 unit. I'm trying to put a symbol. I can define the supplier. I think so it's good to define to whom I'm going to supply. So let's say I call it supplier. It didn't find, you can see, I have a result. So I can create the record directly. And so I have here the supplier form, which is the particle, I showed you. Already filled with the name I typed it. And here I just, I could put, for example, the VAT number. We check the VAT, so I will not put the VAT. yeah, and I could put the supplier payment term, for example, how the supplier asked me to pay. For, let's say the conditions pay after 30 days, so I select 30 days. And I can select a payable account, which will be used to store the payable for the supplier. And the tax rule, no tax rule. But here I could have tax rules which define how tax apply to by this supplier. I can define here the name and the code of the product at the supplier. So you could name it differently than the, my way of naming the product. And I could put here a lead time to reorder it. For example, it asked me 5 days to between when I make the command, the order, and when I receive it. And I can define the prices per quantity. So let's say we have a first price at 10. And after that, if I purchase for 50 units, I have a purchase price of 6. And now I have to be able to set, I have to define the revenue account for this product and the expense. I could use a category. Where it's defined. For now, let's say I'm here. So now I have my product with two variants. Let's sell it. Go to sell. And I create a new sale order for a customer. So a customer. Doesn't exist, so I'll create it quickly. It selects automatically the address to invoice and the shipment where to ship. I could, here the customer could have multiple addresses. The addresses are here. But I could So we have strips 1 and another 1, 2, and so I can here select zip code, and here I can select the other address. And so I can invoice on another address and ship another one. Now I will fill my sell order here. So I have the lines, so I will sell my t-shirts. So I create two values, so there is two t-shirts, and I will sell two medium and five XL. So automatically the price is there, it computes the amount, and we have the shipping date, which is today, because we said that we can ship directly. It computes the amount, the taxes. I have not defined taxes, but it would have computed. And we have the total here. Now I can make a quotation. Once I have the quotation, I can get a report, a quotation report. Now where it's open. Here the quotation, so the same screen, the same information than on the order. And once it's done, I can confirm if the customer agrees on the sale. So I confirm, and now I can process, which means that it will create all the shipment and invoice if needed and so on. Now we have also a cron task that can do it automatically. But here I don't have the cron running, and so I will process manually. So it's pretty fast. And here you can see that based on here, I didn't show you, but we have defined the invoice method and the shipment. So we invoice when the order is processing, and we ship when the order is processing. So it should have created an invoice and a shipment directly. So I have here the invoice. I can open it. And you can see it's pretty the same as the sale order. And I have a shipment here where I have two moves for each quantity, and I have my the shipment here, which said I have to, it's planned for today, I have to ship this product. So let's go to the shipment and try to ship. So it's defined that it used my warehouse, and I will try to assign, which means I will reserve the product in the location. To reserve for this order to the product. So you try to find in which location the products are and where I have to be. So if I click on assign, indeed that means that I have no products in the house, so I cannot ship it. So I could force, because I could say, okay, I know that's the products are in the warehouse, even if the system does not. But instead, I will generate purchase one and receive before shipping the product. So for that, I will go on the purchase. I miss a module. I'm missing the purchase request. The stock supply module where we click install it. So you can see it's pretty easy to install the module. Was looking at the wrong place. On the warehouse, I can now run the supply stock, which will look at what I have in the stock, what are the demands. So in some way, the customer shipment is a kind of need, or I have to ship this product, but I don't have them in the warehouse. So it will compute and create purchase requests for the missing product. Maybe it's clearer if I go, I can show you here, the warehouse. You can see that for the t-shirt I have zero quantity, but the forecast quantity of minus two, so I need two products in the warehouse. If I run the supply stock, okay, it tells me that I have customer moves. So here, if I go, I have some waiting customer shipments that are in the past, and so I should have rescheduled them to know how to compute correctly what I need in the warehouse, but I will just ignore them for now. And of course, there is but so the wizard run, and I have now two purchase requests. Here it tells me that I need five products of except t-shirts. But as I define that I purchase by a box of 10 on the product, it tells me that I have to buy one box of 10. Let's see, make the rounding. And for the empty shirts, it's almost the same. I need two units, but I have 10 box. I can purchase only by 10 box. So for now, it tells me to purchase zero, but because you want it. But I can adjust because I want to purchase some. Indeed, we could probably improve that to round up instead of round down. So that changed. I select the purchase request, and I will select to create the purchase, so I want to purchase them. So ES created the purchase order. I can find them in the purchase place here. So I have from my supplier here the purchase order for the two t-shirts, two kinds of t-shirts. I can request a quotation for the supplier. The supplier give me, I can, maybe he changed a little bit the prices. You can see here by default he used the prices I put on the definition, but they say he changed a little bit and now it's, this one is a little bit, cost a little bit more. So I can go back and now I confirm the order and process. So it automatically generates the invoice that we are going to wait from the supplier and the shipment. And it doesn't create exactly the shipments, but it creates the two products, the two moves that we are going to wait. And now we can go the supplier delivery us in the warehouse. So we are at the warehouse and we receive a shipment from the supplier. So I go to the supplier shipments and I start to create. It's the supplier name, supplier. And here I will look at what he shipped me. So I look at the package and I see that, okay, there is a box of empty shots and another box of XL t-shirts. So I select them. I could change also the quantity. Let's say he shipped me two boxes, maybe by mistake, for example. So I can change the quantity. Or I can also adjust the price. Let's say at the end, on the shipping notes, the price is a little bit lower for whatever reason. So I can change also here the price. And now I can make the reception. Once I've received, it's in my incoming location. And I have now to move it into the storage location here. I could have multiple locations in the warehouse and so I could put in different places. So here I could select to move it in a different location. I have only one, but I could create another one. Location, which is under the storage location. And that I could move it, the Italian t-shirts in another place. And now I can make the reception. If I go back to my locations and I open the warehouse, I can see that for my t-shirts, now I have 10 in the warehouse and the forecast, because we normally sold two t-shirts today, the forecast that we will have only 8 t-shirts today. And I have 20 of the XL t-shirts and I sell 5, so I have 15 now in the forecast. So now, if I go back to the customer, customer shipment, I can make my reservation here for the product. And he selects automatically the second location storage for the 5 products of XL t-shirt, because it's where I put them when I receive the supplier shipment. So it tells me where to look at the products. And now I can make the shipments, so ship it to prepare the package and send it to the customer. So I'm going to send. And the date is updated to when it was shipped. I have also a delivery note. Let's open it. Yeah. I have a delivery note with this shipment. Now I can go back to my sale, which is in processing here. I see the state of the shipment is sent. And I've still the invoice, which is waiting. So I can open the invoice and post it in the accounting. So if I post, the invoice receive a number, and I can print it to send it to my customer. And so you have what's sold and the amount. Yeah. So that's mainly all the workflow. Maybe we can check our products about I put it here a cost, an average, to compute the cost price on average. And as you remember, I said that I received my box of 10 for 10 euros. So computed that the cost price of a t-shirt is 1 euro. And for the XL, I changed the price to 11, and so the cost price of one XL t-shirt here is 1.1 euro. So it automatically computes the cost, it adjusts the cost price automatically. I don't know if you want to, if there is any questions or... Yeah? Yes, we have a module for that. The question is, could we have on the variance define attributes for the t-shirt? And indeed, we can. There is a module, attributes, product attributes, that I will install now. Now I've installed the attributes module. I have to define the attributes I will assign to the product. So the definition is by you define a set of attributes that will be used. So I will create, let's say, t-shirts attributes, and now I can create define, for example, the size. So I will give the name size, and the label is size. So I can tell you that. And I will define as, for example, a section. And so I will have, for example, I could say small. So I define the key and the value, the label of the key, large, extra large, and so on. I could create another one, for example, colors. And here, let's say it's a free text, people will type the color. So I save it. And now on my t-shirt product, here, it's expanded. I have a new tab attribute. I can select that I want the t-shirt attribute, the set t-shirt attribute, I go, so now I save it, and I will assign to each of my variants, I will define which attributes I will use. So now here, so this is the variant, the n, the small. So I can select, define the size, and say it's a small. It's a small. And I can pick a color and say it's white. And now it's saved. I can select, here is my second t-shirt, the XL. And I can, so, I can select the size, XL, and another color. Now, I've both, I have stored each information on each t-shirt. Of course, you can have different set of attributes by kind of product. So on the models here, you select which set of attributes. You, if you sell, if I sold also, I don't know, shoes. I could put also the size of the shoes, define the attribute set with the selection of shoe size and so on. So yeah, that's, you are free to define whatever you want. On the technical point of view, now with the last version of Tryton, here the attributes by default are stored as a dump of JSON in the database, the shard field. But in the new version, you can define the database to be a JSON column. And so it's the database knows the structure of the data, of the attributes. And then you can make queries to search by keys and values, and you can have index on it and so on.
Could the attributes have an impact on the same price?
For now, no.
Yes.
But you can write a custom module and the issue is that the attributes are, you are free to define whatever you want. And so it's always complicated to, when the user define whatever he wants, and to use it after a while to make computations. But I think probably doable to, on the price list, so you can define price list, which are mainly a set of rules where you have this one. Here you define rules, so you have matching criteria and after that word a formula. You can match by default by category or product. So here we could have our t-shirt. I say the unit price is 10% of the unit price. You could here imagine that you have a criteria which is the attribute set and another criteria which is key value matching. I don't know if it's clear.
The idea behind, of course, is on the workshop, when the customer selects the different options, he should see the final price for the part of the item increase or decrease, depending on what he is choosing as a
option. But here, I think it's more about creating the variance on the fly. I guess what you think about is when you don't have all the variants in your system, all the possible time, but the customer selects some attributes and then you create the variant for him once he created. And I think you will not use price list to compute the price for that, but probably the way you generate the variant, you will attribute a price based on the formula.
But there is no price on the variant.
There is no price on the variant. The price. That's a point in Tryton. We put by default, we try to be simple by default, and so we choose to put the list price on the template of the variant, because this way it's easier to create a special, to add a field list price on the variant that change from the template that is different, or computed, or whatever. We do it this way because if we have done the other way, it was impossible to have what we have now, because if we define on the lower level, we cannot say we change and we use the upper level. But indeed, for me, here you could have a list price that is computed with a formula on the variance, based on the criteria.
Okay, the reason why you save some place of the in this way.
typically what you, I think the kind of design you will have is here you will define an extra cost.
Yes.
You have the list price, which is the base price of your product, and here you will say, okay, the M is, there is no extra cost, and the XL, you have two euros extra.
Discount is very usual.
Discount comes after. I think discount is done with the price list. And you have the base price. And of course, you don't show to the customer that everything is based on the base price on the template, and you add extra cost for each variant. You show only the base price of the variant. But it's the way you compute. Like that, if you, for example, the base price of your t-shirts increase, the cotton is the price of the cotton is raised. So you just change here the 20 to 20, and all your variant price adapt depending of your data. I think it's the way to do.
I ask from a YouTuber, can we search product by attributes?
Not on the client, not me. Here we cannot. But if you use a dictionary, JSON columns in the database, you can write a query for that. That will use the JSON syntax of PostgreSQL, and you can also have indexes on special keys and so on. So it could be fast, but it's not included by default in Tryton client. The reason is, for now we don't have the tools or to express here in the search bar, we have a kind of syntax. It's a language where you have a compression here. And we need to find, for example, I can search here for all the goods with the name t-shirt, or just the name, or just the t, for example. Mm-hmm. We don't have a way to express the attributes of the product. Yeah, that's, but if you think about webshop, where you rebuild your webshop in your backup server, there you can have you can generate query that the database will understand and will be able to answer quickly. That's the power of this design of the attributes. It's that we don't use the EAV, entity attribute value. So the typical case of most of the webshop is to use a second pillar where we use store all the attributes for each product. And so you have, for each record you have in your table, product table, you have 10 records in this attribute table. And so it becomes a very big table. And when you make the search, you have to do a join on both, and it starts to be very less efficient, and it could have very bad performance. With the dictionary, the JSON progress, you have all in one row, so you don't have an extra job to do, and you have the freedom of storing whatever you want in the JSON. So
I have another question. Can we have some case on the account move template? Review some case on the account move template?
Yes. So the question is, can we see how to use the account move template? So I will go. First, I will just show what is an account move. So in Tryton, we have here the account move. It's indeed an operation in the account team. So it's always based on a journal and on a period. It's the accounting usual data. And you have moves where indeed you debit and credit some amount from one account to another. And an account move needs to be balanced, which means that you have debit the same amount that you have credited to be able to validate and to post it into the accounting system. And so what we have saw that we have a customer invoice that I have posted here, and when I posted it, it generates a move here, this move that I could open and see that we have debited the receivable account of the customer, and we have credited the revenue from the account of each product with the proper price for each product sold. That's a way to do it. And we have the supplier invoice, where we have the supplier invoice that we have generated from the purchase. But indeed, sometimes you don't want to fill a full supplier invoice to register your expense. For example, phone bills is something that is pretty standard, and you just want to record the amount of the bill, and you don't need to fill all the form, the supplier invoice, because you don't do so much. For that, you have the templates in here. You have the Acon move template. The Acon move template, it's a way to define a kind of generic accounting move where you will put just few keywords that you will just complete when you create one move. For the case of the phone deal, all we need to know is just the supplier, so the phone company, and the amount of the deal. So we will create create a phone deal template, define two keywords, one keyword for the party, the supplier. So I will name it supplier. And I say it's a party, and I need to fill it. Maybe I will name it phone company. And I will create another keyword for the amount of the deal. So I put amount. And this is a numeric with two digits. And it's also required to create. I go now in the template tabs. I define on which journal this move will be generated. It's an expense. And now I will create the template for each line in the move. So I will first predict credit of the amount of the bill my expense account, and on the payable account I will say you fill with the supplier key. I use the supplier keyword I created before. So I will say I have to pay to the supplier I will select, and I will debit for the same amount, for example. Here I define taxes, if I have taxes to apply on it. So I save the template, and it saved, it means I didn't make any typo in the keyboard. For example, if here I spend wrongly the amount keyboard. I thought there was a check, but there is no check. So I hope I didn't make any typo. And now I can go to here on the entry menu. Outside the configuration, I could say create a move from a template. So if I run the wizard, it asks me for which template. So I say it's a phone deal. For which period? By default, it selects you the current period, which is most of the case the right period. And now it asks me for which company. We say it's the telecom, so we create the party directly, and like a phone build of I click create, and now it automatically creates the move ready to be posted, where it changes all the keyword with the value I fill it in the wizard. So now here it used the page. It puts the party I just created for the payable account and use the 15 SDD credit value. And now I can just post. I could of course create templates which is more complex and do here on the templates, for example, I could let's say I have taxes, an invalid, I pay taxes of 10%, so I have to credit payable of the amount of the bill, and I will spread 10% in the tax account and 19% in the expense account. And now, if I rerun the phone bill, select the company, and I will use the bill. And now it created, it automatically adjusts the computation with percentage, and so I can fill the two. So it's a way to quickly encode small expenses, for example. Or you can have other kind of moves. That's
yeah. Yeah, so two questions. Thank you first for your presentation. First one, how do you set up initial stock for goods? Okay, first I'll
yeah. So how to set up the initial quantity in the stock? First, you have to define how you structure your warehouse. As I saw, you have created a second location. By default, Tryton comes with this. So you have the one warehouse, one input zone, one output zone, and one storage zone. And at some point, you may want to create more zone inside your storage zone. That's the initial point. You have to define how to manage. And a location defines the way you are going to do the inventory. When you are going to count the product in one location, it's always per location. So it's the way you are doing inventory. So you can have only one location for all your warehouse, because when you do an inventory, you do the inventory of all your location. That's the way of doing. But of course, that means the system will just tell you that the product is in the warehouse, and not precisely where it was put, but can define more sublocation. So it's a tree, so you can have any level you want. But you should be careful. The more level you create, the slower the system will need to compute, because there's multiple more operations performed to compute. You can. When you define a location, you can define that it's a flat children location. This means that you can have only one sub-level, and then, in this case, you can create 100 or even more locations inside, and the computation will not suffer from this. You can have a lot of sub-location, but you have to activate this, because there is a constraint, you can have only one sub-level. That's a thing. And now, once you have set up your location, to enter your initial inventory, you create an inventory pool. And here, you start Wait a minute, no. I was going to say something more.
Because it may impact the account.
Yeah, indeed, there was a question on the back about that. And we make a change. Indeed, you should not do an inventory. Yeah. The best is to use move. You are going to create a move for every location, for every product. and you pick the supplier location for this product. Always, it's the didn't show that, but at the location with the here the warehouse, which is and the storage location, which are what the company owns. But we have here a set of other type of location. We are a kind of fictive location. The products there are not owned by the company. It's not part of the company, but as we use a double entry system for the stock, when you send the product to a customer, you have to send somewhere for the system to be balancing. And so we create these virtual locations. And so we have one customer, one supplier location. It's where we send the product or we receive the product. And we have a lost and found. It's where we lose the product. We have a production and a transit location, which is used when we create production, the part of the product that we use to generate a new product is gone there. And the transit location is when you move from one warehouse to another warehouse. In the meantime, the product is somewhere in the transcription. So I have the supplier location, and I will use here the supplier location because what I have to do when I initially start my to fill my warehouse is that the product comes from the supplier. Because you need to define the cost price, to define it's something you have bought sometime in the past, but we don't care exactly when. But we need to have an initial point because it's important when we will recompute the average cost price of the product. It's important that the product. The move that took the product in the warehouse comes from the supplier, and so it's part of the cost price of the product. If it was, if you do an inventory of the location, it will come from the lost and found, and so it will be like if we the product we have now in the warehouse come from nowhere with no cost at all. And so it will not be used to recompute the cost price, the average cost price of the product, because it's something you have found free. So it's free. It has no cost. So to be sure that the system, when we will recompute the average cost price, use the initial cost price of your product, you have to create a move from the supplier to each location for each product. And indeed, it doesn't create more work than creating an inventory, because at the end, you have to fill the same amount of data. And so you do it like that. So I would say, if in my storage, my second location, I have a product. I have 10 units. Here I have to put a unit price, so it's my cost price, my actual cost price, my current cost price. I don't know, it's 100. Like that will be the base of the recomputation of the average cost price. I save it, and once I've created all my moves, of course I have a lot of moves, let's say, from okay. Here I have to do the bit. So the list of all my moves, I have the button do, so I can do one move at a time if I want, but I could also select all of them, or in the state draft, I can select all the moves and select here do, and it will do all the moons around the sphere. So it's a way to quickly validate on it.
But if you do so and you have this virtual storage system, what happens on the accounting side with the products? I mean, you put it
it's the initial, the starting point of your the initial setup. By default, Tryton doesn't make any accounting stuff, but you do things on the side. But we have two modules that you can activate. We have the account stack continental and the account stack Anglo-Saxon, which add two methods on to perform, to post the accounting a move. For each move you do on the stack, but not on each, on the moves that come from the supplier. So when you receive product, it will post on your accounting the cost of this product in the account stock, in the account stock. And when you send the product, it's only the Anglo-Saxon. The Anglo-Saxon, when you sell the product, it will compute the cost of the product sold and create the credits. And so if you have this activated when you do the initial report of your move, it will automatically create the move for your activity.
But if you already have, if you installed this module and you want to do the setup for the inventory,
it messes up things. Yeah, of course, you have to do the stuff in the right order. you have first to create all your products. After that, you have to import the stuff and make a financial, initial move for your situation of your accounting.
If the accounts for the stock are not defined, define them afterwards, I think there is the...
If you indeed, so there is multiple way. Indeed, when you activate the account stock modules, the methods is defined per fiscal year. So you can define this fiscal year, I do the continental stock accounting, and the next fiscal year, I do something else, another method or something. So you can change from one fiscal year to another. So you could probably import with no accounting stock methods, and after that change it. There is no proper way. It depends on the way you want to do it and how you set up your system. The other point, if you have all the moves created when you import the stock, you can make just your balance move with the initial situation and just skip the account, the stock account, because you have already filled it. That's,
thank you.
Could you use a supplier shipment instead of move for the initial stock? Could you specify supplier to location?
But this means you have to choose. Could we use the supplier shipment instead of the move to make the initial inventory? Probably, but you will need to have more information because you will need to know each product from which supplier it comes, each product you have in your warehouse. And I don't think it's something that is really needed. And also, you have all the supplier shipment will create two moves. One, you will receive first the move in your incoming location, and after that, move it into storage location. I think it's more work for no benefits.
Okay. But there could be a module for implanters, like a setup. Because if you are using like Tryton as company, is the other way, then implementers have to import stocks always.
So if we could have a custom module for import, people are free to customize the system if it's needed. If you have often you need to import, you manage your stock in another system and you have to synchronize, of course. You need to find a way, a strategy to do it.
If we prefer to use a move instead of the inventory for product cost reasons, shouldn't we change the inventory function? Because every time we find a product, we have a product cost problem.
So the question is, should we not change the inventory to support the cost of the product? Indeed, when you do an inventory, what you are registering is that if you have found or lost a product, and you don't know what happens to the product, the difference you have between your quantity and what you have come into your warehouse physically, the difference, by definition, you don't know from where it comes. Is it something, the product that was stolen by someone, or was it broken and trashed because, but never reported or whatever? Anyway, this doesn't change the cost of your product.
If the product existed.
Yeah, if the product exists. Of course, when, but that's always, it's when you compute with the average cost price, when your warehouse, your product level goes to zero, you lose all the history, whatever happens. That's the property of the average cost price computation. Once you go to zero, the past is forgotten. You may want to use FIFO instead, so you will not lose this information. And of course, if you use FIFO, when you make an inventory and you lose product, you will lose the product at the cost of the next one you should pick. Because we lose the FIFO. You lose also using FIFO.
Okay, I think we will still have problems to understand and to make it understood by customers. Because inventory and move and cost.
I think it's a local problem as well, because last week I had a discussion with a customer. Inventory in Germany means everything which was not in the inventory. The warehouse, you know. If you do an inventory in Germany, you do
you count all the products in your
all the and the products they are not in the inventory. They are not in the warehouse.
Yeah.
You know, you have to they have to go out. And now in this design, you do a correctness of all lines you have. But it could be that you have products with a stock which are not in the inventory, and they will be untouched. You have 5,000 products.
Yeah.
You make an inventory with 4,000 lines.
Okay.
What happens to the 1,000 products that you have not touched in the inventory? They, in Germany, they must go to zero.
And now the
1,000 are untouched.
Indeed, when you do an inventory, the right way to do it is first you pick the location, you are doing the inventory, and you have to click here, complete inventory.
It's impossible in our case. We have checked 100,000 products.
Okay, we could make improvement. But here, we have all the products that the system knows about. And, of course, it takes, you have the expected quantity, so what you have in the system, and you cannot edit, and the quantity you count. And here, for example, I could say F0. And just post this inventory. And automatically, it will have created, something we can see, a move. It moved 44 products to Lost and Found.
So if you
cannot miss a product. When you click on complete inventory, it fills with all the products.
But
if you have a lot of products, probably you should split your warehouse in multiple locations to be able to have locations that are manageable, where you can manage to do the inventory. Reduce to
I can do it. The problem in our case is the people is counting manually in the warehouse, and after that they have a list which we import to inventory.
Of course, you can make this offline. You can make it work offline.
Yeah.
You can generate the inventory with the list of all the products, export it on the document, they fill it, and after that, what you import back. And you just have to fill the value quantity. And you can do it later. The system here, the expected quantity, depends on the day. So what it does is it compares the expected quantity with the quantity. So you can post your inventory days after you have done your inventory. It will adjust back in time. And it will not be affected by the new movement that happens when after you have made the inventory and before you have validated.
And we have made, for example, you can put like a barcode to the product.
Yes, everything is done. The problem is if you have 600,000.
But the customer can complete like a spreadsheet.
Yes.
And
also,
run a process script.
But I cannot print all possible 600,000 lists with this product. The way he do it, he goes to the warehouse, makes a list, he imports, and after that he wants that all the products not in this list are set to zero.
Yeah. Of course, but.
You
just have to develop that importation script will complete the inventory and put zero for everything in the file.
I've seen in other software that you have two separate kinds of inventories. One is for starting inventory, in the initial inventory. Usually if you buy a shop, then there are goods and you have to give some money for the goods and then you want to make an initial inventory. So why not have a column with a unit price where I can address the unit price if I have a unit price, if there is no unit price.
Okay. The question is why not have a special inventory form for the initial stock. Of course we could, but we cannot use the current one inventory. I think it will be wrong to put a unit price here, because most of the time you don't have to put a unit price. And it will confuse the user, because it will not know what to put and so on. And at some point, the initial inventory doesn't need all the tools that the current inventory has to compare with the expected quantity and so on. So I think it will be wrong to reuse the inventory, but if someone wants, he could probably propose to create a document initial setup and which have a look similar to inventory and just use the move and make the do button quickly. Yeah, that's a possibility. Mm-hmm. But indeed, when you start, your move is empty, so filling the list with the new move like I show, normally should not be too much complex. And you can verify after a while, you create all your drive move, you go back to the location, open it and see the quantity for each product and you can check that you have the same. I don't know, but yeah, that's always a possibility. No question?
Okay. Well, still about inventories, but for the case, and we talk about this, when you have a lot of location, but I'm thinking about one product from one location using the flat children, and to do inventories is about one location, so I wonder if anyone here has the case to store one product in one location and to do inventory one inventory per product.
Okay. So the question is, if you have a lot of locations, is it possible to make one inventory for all the locations? Indeed, at some point it's not possible because you have to define the quantity for each location. So at the end, what you will create is a kind of super document of inventory of inventory, which contains a lot of inventory for each location. So I don't think it will be very useful. The unit is really the location. So it's I think it's a strategy of the company to decide will they go with large location, and so when they do inventory, they count everything in it and take times. Or you can go the other way, is to create a lot of small locations, and instead of doing a full inventory of your warehouse, you perform a kind of rolling inventory where you will pick up randomly, I will make an inventory of this small location where I have normally three products and go quickly and count that I have three products and adjust permanently you make an inventory permanently for small location pick up from time to time. I know that I read that Amazon is working like that. They're large. And indeed, the location is a small box in a shell where they can put, I think, maybe 10 products. And so the way of working is that when someone picks a product in the box, he has to count what is in the box. So he picks the product and counts what is left, and so they do an inventory when you pick something in the box. So this way, it's always up to date at some point. So it's a way of doing. So you have to choose. You cannot, at some point, you cannot have both a big, large, and not big inventory to do, and have a lot of small locations where you can say where each product is. You have to define your balance, and you can adjust it wherever you want. Yeah?
That was my first question. Second question is, can you just highlight a little bit the closure process?
For accounting?
Yeah, for accounting, of course. I tried it, and when I had some draft invoices, it was raising errors or something like that.
Yeah. So the question is about the closure procedure for the fiscal year. So first we have physical ears, where we have to close them. So it's happened in the processing. Yeah, you can close here your physical ear with just clicking on the close button. And what does the close? It prevents create any move on this physical ear. But indeed, you have some operation to perform before closing. You have to what we have, what we call the non-deferral actons, should be balancing. So in some way, you have to put your revenue and expense into a into an income. And make it an asset or liability for the next year.
Do we do it manually?
Alors, first, so with this, so when you create, you define your chart of account, yeah, maybe I should start with that. I have here my account, and so I have some accounts that I will defer to the next year. So the balance will be ported to the next year. It's pretty standard. And indeed, in Tryton, it does nothing. The computer, it automatically takes the previous balance and put it as the starting balance for next year. It's automatic. So those accounts, normally, you have nothing to do. So it's typically the cash account, the payable and receivable accounts are automatically deferred to the next year, because if people owe you this year's money, it owes you next year also the same money. You have another kind of account, like the expense or the revenue, which are not deferred, and you have to put it back into your incomes at some point. You have to balance those accounts. To balance those accounts, we have created here a wizard. Balance non-deferral account. You can run it. You have to define for which fiscal year. Let's say I will close this one. You have to define a journal. It's a journal that needs, that is a situation journal. It's a special journal for the end of the period, generally. So I will create the situation. Sequence, and I have to define the debit and credit account. So this will be all the non-deferral accounts will be moved into those debit or credit accounts. So if it's if you have a positive result, if you earn money during the year, you will credit a specific account. You can debit another. Some countries have two different accounts, if it's a positive result or a negative result. Or you can use the same for both, it's up to you. And so I will have to create one. I will create one in the app. And it's something like that. And it should go into... and of course it should be deferred, because we are doing deferred. I think something like that. I will do the same here. So I have my situation. I have to use a period, and again it's a special period, an adjustment period. Usually you put it at the for the last day of the fiscal year. So I will go name it closing, and I put it up.
seconds, I will use, of course, the seconds of the same year. And it open. And now I select my result account. So where the balance will be put. If it's a debit or credit, I can choose a different account. I run it. And it creates nothing because I guess I have nothing in this year. let's see. If, of course, I have no movement this year, so I will directly, let's see if we have something for current year. Yeah, here I will close the 17. So, but for first, I have to close 16, and I can close just by clicking because everything is balanced because I do no move. If I try to close 17, it will tell me, okay, I cannot close because first I have some non-posted moves in this period, so I have to postpone the move for this year. Draft. Okay, I have some bank account that are not posted. I will post them. Okay. And now I can try to close, and it tells me that my expense account is not balanced because it's a non-referral account, and I have to balance it. So now I will run my the visa for 70. Use the situation. I have to create a new period. New closing period for 70. So I'm closing the fiscal year. I use the result account for debit credit. And now I run the wizard and it generates, it shows me the moves or the move lines that it generated. So it puts, I have this amount in revenue. This amount in expense, and so you make a credit for the difference as a result. So this is what I earned during this fiscal year, a good performance. And so you just need to post this move to finish the, to be able to close. But now if I try to close, as the move generated is still in draft. And so you can still adapt if you are not satisfied with the closing, I don't know, maybe you want, you, probably you have your tax to include into this accounting. So you have to compute what you have to pay to the state and so on. And, but here it's the accounting job. I don't think I think it will be complicated to include this computation of the acquisition tax into the system. Is it solving your okay? Yeah, you know.
Should we make a small break for 10-15 minutes and then continue with the presentation?
Indeed.
Because we...
After that I was going to talk about future for.
Yeah, cool. Then it's a good time to break, isn't it?
Okay.